Okay, so the next speaker is Rohini Devasher.
So our panel has been talking about valuations of nature, or ways in which nature has been absorbed into various systems of thoughts and beliefs. And one of the areas I often look to is science fiction. In her short story, Vaster Than Empires and More Slow, science fiction writer Ursula K. Le Guin describes the encounter of a group of humans with an alien biosphere that cannot be grasped in any of its parts without understanding its underlying planetary connectedness. Here, the alien planet is alien, not because it is not of this Earth, but rather because of this quite different frame of reference. Everything the humans know, every strategy they would employ to try to understand this planet has to be rethought. So today, I'd like to share one work of mine, and through that, talk about some of the ways in which I have found to engage engage with the interfaces between nature, culture, human and non-human. Directly ahead, the ground was indeed completely flat. To right and left, at the limits of the floodlit area, the rising curve could just be detected. They might have been walking along a very wide, shallow valley. It was quite impossible to believe that they were really crawling along the inside of a huge cylinder, and that beyond this little oasis of light, the land rose up to meet, no, to become the sky. An unidentified object enters our solar system. We soon learn that the object is a perfect cylinder, 54 kilometers long in diameter, and it's headed straight for the sun. This is Arthur C. Clarke's 1973 novel, Rendezvous with Rama. What follows is a gradual unfolding of what lies within that alien cylinder, the Rama of the title. A world turned outside in with the cylindrical sea that arches above the explorers' heads, possible cities dotted around the inner circumference, and artificial light provided by three suns, three linear suns, embedded in giant trenches in the walls. Yet Rama, the unfamiliar, has strangely familiar undertones. So I first read the book more than 25 years ago. Oh, thank you. I first read the book more than 25 years ago, but Rama's climate, if you will, has stayed with me, with its peculiar quality of light, ideas of interiority, inversion, and a strangeness, not of haunting, but of wonder. So the theme of encounters between the natural and technological, human and non-human, where surprising intersecting patterns between the two become are made visible, is something I continue to explore through my work today. Over the past few years, I've become increasingly conscious of the methods of fieldwork and expedition in my practice. I'm also interested in the different ways the field functions. So the field is a place or a group of physical sites in which evidence of past activity is preserved. As a mode or a methodology, it is a space for investigation that allows you to explore something unfamiliar rather than a moment of necessarily acquiring knowledge. A site will never be what you expected. Neither will your reaction to the site be what was expected. The landscape, weather, your tools, camera, audio recorder, sketchbook, all function differently. Circumstances come together to force you to do what you can under a very specific set of circumstances. Once you have collected and recorded what you could, you make something of this collection, not of what you thought to collect. You begin to speculate to create fictions. So my visit to the Mount Aso volcanic crater or caldera in Japan was one such experience. 47 kilometers south of Kumamoto, the tiny town of Aso sits in the middle of Japan's second largest volcanic caldera. It isn't rare to see calderas of this scale, but a caldera with an interior stable enough to cultivate land, build highways, lay railroads is quite rare. So geologically unique, with a circumference of approximately 120 kilometers and five peaks within its basin, the site also has a high occurrence of mist and fog and descending cloud. It seems like a place that should be shrouded in legend and mystery. As Simon Sharma puts it, once a certain idea of landscape, a myth, a vision, establishes itself in an actual place, it has a peculiar way of muddling categories, of making metaphors more real than their reference, of becoming, in fact, part of the scenery. So the work that emerged out of this particular expedition, Spheres, is a video and a drawing-based work in three parts. And it's the closest I've come to capturing or expressing the climate that I associate with Clarke's book. Lying somewhere between reality and fiction, the video footage shot on site at the caldera is reimagined, so we seem to be looking inside some form of hollowed out space, possibly a sphere. We see a volcanic cinder cone crater, which stands as a sentinel of past upheaval. We see mist, cloud, and fog, a distant horizon, an atmosphere. A sun, possibly artificial, simulates a daylight cycle, illuminating and obscuring the landscape by turns. A recognizable pattern in an otherwise strange, but not entirely alien landscape. So the film is projected onto a large site-specific wall drawing, where the video and the drawn mark interact in unexpected ways and complete the work. The drawing that forms the base for the video work draws from the history of geology, astronomy, volcanology, when the Earth was still being explored as an entity within space. So it brings together specific moments of the depiction of our planet as a sphere or a whole. This is the hollow Earth theory, where it was believed that another world existed at the center of the planet, which could be accessed through openings at the North and the South Pole. This is a cross-sectional drawing of the planet Earth showing the interior world of Atvatabar, and this is from William R. Bradshaw's 1892 sci-fi novel, The Goddess of Atvatabar. Another is the Homeric view of Earth in 900 BC, where the Earth is represented as a flat, circular disk of land surrounded by a continuous ocean stream. In this interpretation, the world is like a plateau on the top of a mountain surrounded by Oceanus, the world river, and from its periphery rises the fixed dome of the sky. The sun, the moon, and the stars rise from the waters at the edge of the dome, move in an arc above the Earth, and then sink once again into the sea to complete their course beneath Oceanus. And then there is, of course, Jules Verne's journey to the center of the Earth, where the volcano becomes the portal through which the hollow Earth was accessed. So juxtaposing these ideas of the Earth with Clarke's Rama and similar space habitat designs like the Dyson sphere, the O'Neill cylinder, the Bernal sphere, spheres then is a jigsaw of alternative maps or plans of new terrains and fictions created through the layering of drawn mark with video, an alternative hybridized world, once familiar and now strange. In 1610, Galileo published his extraordinary Sidereus Nuncius, or the Starry Messenger, the first scientific treatise based on his observations of the moon through a telescope. His drawings depict a moon scarred and pitted, an astonishingly irregular but not so unfamiliar surface. And I quote, "This lunar surface, which is decorated with spots, like dark blue eyes in the tail of a peacock, is rendered similar to those small glass vessels which, plunged into cold water while still warm, crack and acquire a wavy surface." So as various scholars have pointed out, the images that Galileo conjures to describe the lunar world are themselves a species of chimera. These images and metaphors, stemming as they did from ancient myths and fables, are at odd variance with the astronomical frame onto which they were mapped. They were one thing standing in for something else, pushing the limits of the known and the imagined. And what Galileo was trying to do was to create a physical world out of images, to establish some kind of similarity between the Earth and the moon, to try and translate these images from the telescope into something that could be understood by the reader. In rendering the strange conceivable, projection has its limitations. But studies on creative problem solving have shown that one way of gaining new perspectives on a problem is to juxtapose it with something completely unrelated, thereby making the familiar strange. The moment when the unexpected comes in and forces you to pay attention, turning something on its head, asking the question, what if? I like the analogy of a mirror in this context, not just because it references both microscope and telescope, but also because when you mirror something, it's reversed, and very often that reversal is enough to make something familiar very strange. So stranging then for me becomes a strategy for encountering, observing, and finally recording both environment and experience. Stranging as a practice explores the interconnectedness of our relationship to the planet and offers a perspective that may be useful to our imagination of our future in both shaping and living within it. And when walking a fine line between wonder and the uncanny, it can change how we see the world. Thank you.
So let me start with a question, Rohini. Rohini, the vocabulary of strange is, or the rhetoric of strange that you deploy and central to what you're saying, is ambiguous between two things, isn't it? And I'm curious about which one you're stressing and whether you're stressing both. One series of rhetorical remarks you make, stress change with a view to saying that you want inquiry to be exploratory, right? And so the contrast would be with the kind of controlling inquiry that takes place when you explain and predict and so on. It's much more exploratory, so you see it as unfamiliar or strange, and you explore it rather than, as it were, see it in a more controlling way, explain and predict it. So that's one rhetorical use, deployment of strange. But there's the other deployment, which is strange as weird, right? To make it, and that is in fact much more aggressive. That is, you take something unfamiliar, make it strange, presumably with a view to stimulus, to rethink things and so on, which is not exploratory, but actually much more willful. So do you have in mind both? Do you have in mind a conjunction of both?
I think it's a conjunction of both, because when I think of even weird or weirding, I think those can also be equally... I think it is a conjunction of both, because I agree that the second, which would, as you say, if we go into weird or weirding, which can also, at least the way that I'm perhaps interpreting it, can also be very opening, not necessarily in an exploitative, if I understood right way, but it could also equally be, at least it allows you to look at things open, you know, everything is sort of, yeah.
Yes.
Sorry, we have always a problem with acoustics here. Please try to speak clearly loud with the mic.
Rohini, those drawings you showed of different conceptions of the Earth, in a way they're like a telescope of human impressions of world geography or something like that. You know, like, they're very shorthand, your sketches, and very nicely done and beautiful. When you place those kinds of experiences of making from your perspective to the way that the world exists, not that that's natural and this is artificial, not in that sense, how does the world open up to you when you kind of go through these historical moments of thinking about world geography, and then you're recording them as part of your making your work, and then you come out of your work and you live in a landscape, you've just gone on a fieldwork tour, it connects to your discussion about fieldwork. So how does that movement happen for you? How does the drawing, the making, and the fieldwork experience connect to the fact that the world is beyond the making, no? More than the making.
Well, I think because I am an artist, and I find that it helps me make sense of the world also. For this work in particular, because, so when I went to, I deliberately didn't show you images of what Aso looks like, right? Just the site itself. But when I went there, I was immediately struck by how, as I said, it was just lending itself to many, many things. So the work took a long time to come. But as I was making the video, as I was making the piece, and it seemed to automatically need to curve, do you know what I mean? And it became sphere-like. And then it became a question of, well, what are the other ways in which this has happened? And what does that mean to... Because for me, like I said, you know, the work is about many maps. So it's sort of like an exercise in many maps, and not all of them, even when you, so you see just the work finally at the end, but when you encounter the work, so the reason I didn't show the video, for instance, is that, the reason I didn't show the video, for instance, is it's one of those things where I feel like you need to be in the space and you need to see the work with the drawing and the video. So what happens when you're in the site? There are three chapters of the video, and then at different points the drawing comes in and out. So in a sense, you're navigating the drawing anew each time. And there are bits, do you see what I mean? I don't know if I can answer your question entirely, because it's still something that's happening. This is only the second piece I've done where it's been drawing and video together. Like, usually it's separate pieces of work, but in this case, it felt necessary as a way also to add those layers which you could choose to read into if you want to, because there is always text with the work. You don't have to, but then those references, at least for me, it was important to. I don't know if that answers your question, though.
Good talk.
Yes.
Thanks for sharing this. Can you connect the function of the speculative? Oh, I don't mean this. Can you connect the function of the speculative through your work and more generally with the question of how do we reimagine the human condition and more than human condition as a tool for worlding and world making?
I don't know if I have an answer for that. I mean, I can answer to the speculative within my own practice, but I think like those are very big things that I mean, I'm trying to figure it out as I go along. But as I said, the word specular comes from speculative, which is the mirror, right? So like I said, a lot of this is about just taking things and then just twisting them a little bit and then seeing how that works. I mean, as I said, I just did a residency, which was on an oil tanker, and I was on the ocean, of course, in this. Otherwise, I mean, I don't know how some of these things are just experience. I don't know, you know, it's like one of some of these things are just beyond, they need, it's about experience. And I find like some of what I do or some of what art perhaps can also do is make those experiences possible. And beyond that, it's what you take. And then, you know, yes, so that's a difficult question to answer in its.
Sure.
So this is a very vague, unformed question, so. Yeah, you don't even have to answer it per se, but I was just wondering, and it's somehow connected to Maya's question, but what is the relationship between the strange and the political, or kind of how is politics somehow, is it important to your work, or do these speculative or kind of reimaginings or kind of going back to the ways people have speculated or reimagined, does it connect in some ways for you in your artistic practice to A, the human condition, or, you know, sort of ways in which you want to think about sort of relationships between the polity and human,
absolutely.
Non-human, yeah.
But I think again,
and how?
It would be, yeah, absolutely. It would, because I mean, as I said, this is one work. There are many pieces which do. I mean, I've done also the definition of political, you know, like I find so much is political. So I've done a lot of work with amateur astronomers in Delhi. So I'm an amateur astronomer. I've worked with them for like 20 years. So. What is political? Are we losing Delhi's night skies? For me, that's hugely political.
Yeah.
You know, my daughter will grow up without seeing the stars from the city.
Exactly.
So the question of wonder and how I feel like even just the word is losing currency is something that bothers me deeply.
Yeah.
Because I think we need to make a case for wonder in the age of the Thulucene, Capitalocene, Anthropocene, you know, make a case for wonder, because wonder celebrates daring as a mode. It's really important. And absolutely, I agree. I mean, I just think, you know, this word maybe not directly, but I absolutely think so.
And can you wonder without having some kind of longing?
No, I don't know.
So that
can.
So that's in the mix.
Okay. Oh yes.
Yeah. Yes. Yes.
No. Rohini, I just want to ask you, like, you know, since we worked on shows with Mrs. Mehta at the museum, and I think the idea of strangeness comes with familiarity, right? I mean, you know, when we were, you're talking about spheres, and I think before this, we installed deep time over there. I think, you know, when you kind of add different layers to the work itself, the kind of uncanny feeling that you get with it. So I think when you talk about strangeness, there is also familiarity with it, because,
absolutely,
you know,
yeah.
It comes, when you were referring to Mount Aso, and, you know, the entire installation of spheres kind of offshoot from the volcanic eruption that you saw from a distance of 25 miles. So I think, you know, the familiarity is something that has a very strong relation with strangeness. I think that kind of comes out very well within your work and your practice. So
yeah.
Do you just want to kind of elaborate a bit on that?
Yeah. Absolutely, because some of the work that you're talking about also, which was, so one of the other things I was interested in is that, you know, if we look at spaces which we usually associated with the sublime, or, you know, those sorts of experiences which were usually spaces that were devoid of human encroachment and stuff like that. But so when I interviewed these amateur astronomers over a period of time, and it was funny that some moments kept popping up, you know, it was like almost sites of pilgrimage, which were some of these telescope arrays, some of which, you know, I visited several of them. They're in India, in Hanle and in Gauri Bidnur. And there was something interesting about the idea of spaces of technological strangeness also, you know, where man through these machines also is looking at something much beyond and ahead. And it's almost as though this becomes, I'm not saying it's replacing that, but it's almost as though it's these sites then become a space where people are trying to understand their own relationship to the planet, if that makes any sense. So it's, yeah, strangeness in that sense as well, absolutely.
Okay, Rohini, thanks. That's great.
Thank you, Martin. Thank you, Ravi, Max Mueller Bhavan, for inviting me here. And thank you for actually just since last evening and today itself for so many inspiring kind of conversations, moments, thoughts. I'm quite an optimistic guy, and it's very easy. I'm ready to fight tomorrow morning, you know, if we want to stop speculating. But thank you for allowing to speculate as well. So it's quite nice to think aloud. And I'm trying to, in a sense, respond to the brief that Ravi had given in the sense of trying to find another way or multiple ways of comprehending or responding to the question of value or new ways of value of nature, and also to the whole question of the landscape of nature and what does it look like. In many ways, I felt that I was resonating all along, even before I heard you speak, Akeel, and that I, in some way I was also resonating with some of the things that you said. And so without a pressure to have an action plan, without a pressure to respond to what is to be done, I'd just like to start off by referencing to three conversations that I had at very different points in time. And the back end to all of these conversations is really exciting, but it could take a couple around it. So I'm kind of being like extractive and precise. And the first one was when in the 80s was when one of the first times that I went out of the city and hung out in a village and went to a forest and so on, and early 80s, and was speaking to I was speaking to an old Adivasi man, and trying to understand the history of the region and how he looked at life and things and so on. And we kind of ran through independence and the Rajas and the Maharajas and how it used to be and how the forest was and so on. And then it came to the abolition of the princely states. And it's just nothing original from with reference to what everybody has been speaking about, and everybody knows it, but it's something that stuck in my head that he said. And he said then that when the states in the 50s, when or even just before the 50s, when it became clear that the princely states were going to be dissolved, the Maharajas began to fell extensively. They started to cut down whatever forests were under their sovereignty. And they were felling and bringing in the timber into the area that would remain under their control, because the law was saying that whatever is in this area is yours in that sense. And what he said was that when that started to happen, and when we understood that this was happening, we began to fell like crazy as well. So they were taking out the forest, we started taking out. We knew how to take it out better than them. So we also began to take it out. The second conversation that I want to refer to is like almost 15 years later, when like a whole bunch of things were troubling me. For instance, what Mukul was referring to in terms of Adivasi leaderships struggling for many, many years, fantastic struggles, and then getting supposedly, whatever is the right word, corrupted or co-opted repeatedly in different places. And I kept wondering as to why, you know, how come they take this to this point? I kept wondering, kept feeling that people in the cities like me had access to a lot of information, could analyze and so on and so forth. But what would be like? What would it be like if I could somehow analyze the first day of a popular resistance, the second year, the 10th year, the 40th year, and if all these could be put together, how valuable would it be and how interesting would it be? In the mid-90s, in the late 90s, again, not having access to data in that sense, and just in my own kind of Bhelpuri way, I started to like take out newspaper clippings, essentially doing what you referred in terms of investments. You spoke about tracking investments, and I wanted to see where people were coming to. Just so-and-so CEO or so-and-so company, where were they arriving? Which city were they going to? And so on. And I cut out clippings for over like 2 years. Collected them and put them, and it was quite clear, the target areas were quite clear, that is like around 97, 96. The Alpines was a big target. The coastal regions were a big target. The Eastern Ghats was a big target. These, for me, in my little collection, these three were major areas, and then subsequently I began to travel in all these areas and began to film in all these areas and so on, and I was making my great project. I'm grateful to Amrita Patel, who was the head of National Dairy Development Board with whom I was working, who also a member of the Reserve Bank, board of the Reserve Bank, and very influential, and who one day suddenly said that, you know, you have a lot to say, and you're always angry, and so on and so forth. We've just got, and since he just passed away, I thought it would be good to talk about him for a bit, Atal Bihari Vajpayee. So she said that Vajpayee is coming to an adjacent institution for a convocation. And we have a few minutes in his schedule. So I'm going to give you the few minutes. You do what, say what you have to say. So I immediately backed out and said, no, I don't want to, blah, blah, blah. This is not my scene, etc. So she said, challenged me and said, well, I mean, I'm giving you the most powerful man in this country at this moment. You have something to say. You have something to say all the time. Why don't you say it to him? Show him what you want to show. Anyway, to cut a crazy long story short, I had in an auditorium Prime Minister of India, two principal secretaries, the two most powerful men bureaucrats in the country, Chief Minister of Gujarat. I had been given only one condition, which was don't get us into trouble. Say whatever you want to say, show whatever you want to say, show. Which was fine. I mean, I respected that and I didn't get anybody into trouble. Nobody else in the auditorium. I'm jumping to the end of the whole story. So what did I show them? I showed them hell. I showed them complete devastation. I showed them miles and miles of effluent, dried effluent till as far as the eyes can see. I showed them water systems destroyed. If just every conceivable form of Indian ecological horror that you can imagine, I showed them images of that. Quickly put together in 4 days, very, very uncomfortable and having to do it, and following which there was lunch, etc., etc. And these three gentlemen, Vajpayee and the two principal secretaries, were asked very clearly in front of a large number of people, what did you think of the film? You have not said anything. One of the principal secretaries said, I will like defer, I will respond later. The other more senior principal, Vajpayee was the one who was first asked, the PM, and he said, I will respond later. Why don't you respond to his number two man? It's another thing that he wanted to meet in the night and see the film again and have a drink and all that, but that's another story. But he told the number one guy, you respond. And then this guy, in front of a large audience of fairly senior people, board of governors, trustees, etc., etc., said, this is an extremely naive film. And this is 1998, I think, or something like that, 1999. So on being asked, why is it a naive film? He said again, in front of the PM and everybody, that it's naive because we've actually sold everything. So what's the point of bringing all this up after we have sold everything? Openly and very comfortably. My third conversation, because I have only 15 minutes, I can't tell you everything that happened, but I mean, nobody was really startled that he could say this so peacefully and openly. Ke sab bik gaya, bikne ke baad bolne ka kya fayda, which is exactly what he said. In fact, he said, humne sab bech diya, we have sold. That was the third conversation that I want to refer to is, again, shooting, looking around at the horrors here. I came across a situation in Gujarat where they were not releasing effluent in effluent tanks or in rivers or in ditches or anything like that, but they were actually drilling borehole drilling into the groundwater and directly pumping the effluent directly inside. So no trace, no account, no explanation. You don't have to go anywhere. You don't have to hide. You don't have to do anything. You just put your pipe and bang it in. So when I look at, I mean, it's understandable for the old man to understand the old man who said, when everything was being destroyed, we also destroyed. I can understand that. It's shocking to hear the PMO and the PM all saying this openly that everything is sold. It's terrible. It's very shocking. Pumping an effluent directly into the groundwater was hard for me to understand. I don't know whether it is shocking or it's understand. I do not know what is the right way to comprehend this. The only thing that I can say is that this seems to be something else that has gone wrong, if that is fine and can be done, etc. If you look at this landscape of horror across the country, wherever you go, and all of you have gone, and you described it so well, there's another landscape in that, and that is a clay. It's a landscape of assassinations, arrests, mafias, evictions, repeated evictions. Villages have disappeared within 6 months. It's not one power plant, two power plants. It's 40 power plants in a ring. It's all the trees having ash on them. You can go on and on. But there is a landscape of people who have been also completely massacred in many different ways. In prison, unknown people, not leaders, but all of these people have been part of resisting this in one way or the other, whatever way they are doing it, whether it's in a public hearing or whether it's in a demo or whatever you want to say it. But there are people who have been hit and hit bad, and over 30 years, over 40 years. So it's quite a large number of people, as well as on the run. In some way, I'm responding to value, trying to figure out how to find an alternative value, trying to respond to landscape of nature. Also, in some ways, trying to, it was wonderful to be able to show the sovereign forest here some years ago. And in some ways, I'm also trying to lead up to what led me to make it and what was the thinking behind leading up to it. And that's also what I'm trying to do here. If you look at this whole thing, apart from the fact that something seems to be wrong about everything and everybody, the other thing that hits you pretty straight is that it looks all quite fixed. The whole thing is fixed. Wherever you go to the prison, you go to the court, you go to the water pollution board, you go to anywhere, you get a sense of it being fixed. I'm not going into the details of how it's fixed. I can, but you have, and many others have as well. So then I start to think that how can it be that the whole damn thing is fixed and it's fine, it's carrying on. And so then, since I can do this, I start to wonder that maybe we don't know that it's fixed. Maybe we are not comprehending that it's fixed. And maybe it's a cognitive problem. Maybe, as you said, it's a comprehension problem. If it is a comprehension problem, then maybe if we fix this comprehension, it'll get fixed, it'll get resolved. Everybody will understand this is a bad thing going on. but how do we comprehend? And I thought that before you comprehend, one of the first things you need to do before you comprehend is you need to be able to look. So a certain way of looking would create a certain kind of comprehension, and a certain kind of comprehension would create a certain kind of compassion. So before I get to compassion or comprehension, let me withdraw and go back as far back as I can and get to just looking. Let me just look first and find a way to look. When I do that, I say, okay, let me practice how to do this. And so the first thing I do, therefore, is let me look at a crime. And go to the crime, and therefore go to the scene of crime, go to the crime scene and look at the crime scene, just like any investigative agency would look at a crime scene. And when any criminal justice system or investigative agency looks at a crime scene, what do? They collect the evidence from the crime scene, they bring it back, they sift through the evidence. Whatever is rubbish, whatever is inadmissible is dismissed. Whatever is admissible is put together, presented through the system to the justice, to the judge. The judge analyzes this permissible, valid evidence and comes to a conclusion. You may disagree with that conclusion if you want, silently, but nevertheless, that's the conclusion that we all, in some senses, are living with. And I just wondered that what if the definition of valid evidence itself was incorrect? I can, since I'm not in court, I can't say this. That what if what is permissible and what is invalid itself is incorrectly defined. If, hypothetically, for a little while, it is incorrectly defined, then actually they are collecting incorrect evidence all the time and tabling it into the judge as well. And maybe there is some other really valid evidence that's hanging around that nobody's looking. And that is probably why they can't understand. Because how do I comprehend this, that there's a crime that is taking place? Are they not being able to see the crime? Or are they not being able to see the evidence? Or the crime is also visible, the evidence is also visible, but they can't see it. So what's the problem? So of course, I can speculate, but I want to push it a little further, and I say, okay, let me go to a real crime scene. So I'm not just faffing, let me see what happens really. So I really go to a crime scene, and I really start collecting the evidence, and I don't go by the definition of what is valid evidence by law, by the law of the land. And I start collecting what makes sense to me, what makes meaning, what gives me multiple kinds of insight into the crime. The moment I start doing that, I begin to realize I had no idea about the crime. I really didn't understand the crime. I didn't understand its scale, its depth, its meaning. I didn't understand what it meant for this landscape to be destroyed, because the way the landscape gets destroyed, how does it impact on a way of being, a way of existing, a way of thinking, a way of living, a way of eating, a way of everything. And so it's, in a sense, it's not just a landscape that's getting destroyed, but it's a way of being that gets destroyed. And even if I can say that a way of being is getting destroyed, I don't know the meaning of what it means to be destroyed as well. I don't even know what it means. I don't know the scale and the depth of it. I don't know the implications of it. I don't know destroyed for how many decades and how many generations and what are its contours. I have really actually no idea. So when I start to collect this inadmissible, not permissible evidence, and start putting it around from the crime scene, I start putting it around the crime, a few interesting things begin to happen. Of course, the first thing is I start getting multiple kinds of insights into what happened. If I hang around that evidence a little further, I find that when I move, they are not all in the same vocabulary. Not everybody archives in the same way. Not everybody recalls in the same way. So what I have is actually evidence in multiple vocabularies and in multiple forms. And I'm tempted to then ask suddenly that because I'm getting a completely much larger understanding of the crime from your permissible understanding, I'm tempted to say, allow me, let's go to trial. You put your forensic valid evidence on the table and I'll put this one. And let's see what's the nature of comprehension. Let's see what kind of understanding does your lordship get, or for that matter, does anybody get. But apart from that, if I push it a little further, I find that when I move from one form of evidence to another form, and I look at the other form of evidence, there are these strange jumps in understanding that begin to happen. They are totally different vocabularies. But I start to understand, and I'm not quite sure how I'm understanding it. I'm not quite sure whether it's my head is understanding it, my past is understanding it, my body is understanding it. What exactly is understanding? Because I'm understanding repeatedly in different and different and different waves and deeper ways as I go through multiple forms of evidence. And I'm, in a sense, it is quite exhilarating as well. It also gives you a great sense, a realization of your own inadequacy. Come immediately. If you were to take this understanding and take it to the scene of crime and present it to those people who are victims of the crime, the first thing they will tell you is that fantastic, great job, but it's far from the truth. There's much more that you need to know. And so, in that sense, even embracing that inadequacy is gives you a better sense of the complete or the whole or what the real story is or could be. However, after this kind of exhilaration in understanding goes down a little bit, then I start to wonder, and I'm now connecting to what you said last evening, I start to wonder that who has this understanding? I mean, is it the indigenous? I mean, do I have to go and hang out with them and then will I get to know how to think this thing? And so I start to step out and start to check it out and see that where lies this wisdom of multiple forms of comprehension? Where lies this wisdom of existing in a non-alienated way? Of existing in a way that you have lengthy, clear moments of non-alienated existence, where there are no hierarchies, where you can understand, you don't need to be told to understand, you don't need to be told that I should cooperate, etc., etc. It's your being is so intricately non-hierarchical that there is really no difference that somebody else is suffering, not your lover, but anybody else is suffering hurts. Naturally, I don't have to feel bad about somebody else feeling bad, and so on. So where would I get this knowledge? And I'm just about to end. And when I stepped out figuring out who has this wisdom, I was quite shocked. Because I found, at least speaking in a subcontinental way, region, I found that there were a lot of people who had this wisdom. Just everybody, there were guys all over, everywhere, in different traditions, different ways, different religions, spiritual traditions. They had figured it out. They had figured out this neurosis of however, whether you, I'm not trying to let capital off the hook and say this is an internal psychological problem, but I think to quite some extent there is a screw up. There is a self-destructive screw up, no doubt. If you were to look at the digital regime that we are now entering, and your presentation yesterday, it's absolutely crystal clear. The corporate world is totally aware of this neurotic screw-up. And the way the digital regime is operating, it's not surprising that more and more people from Arunachal, like in Arunachal, will say that we want mining or we want this. So in many ways, they are controlling. And they are controlling neurosis. But that's probably better to go into when we talk about future. But coming back to what for me was important was that I found many traditions in this country who understood this gyan, who had figured it out not 20 years ago, 30 years ago, but a really, really long time ago. And they had their own vocabularies, which somehow we all seem to have just sidestepped and are wondering how to experience being interconnected, how to experience emptiness, how to experience shunyata, how to experience how to resist. What is the new method to fight these guys? This absolute roller coaster investment. What's the language of the resistance? It feels that this language and the method is just right around the corner. It's there, and we just need to connect to it. It's been around the corner for a really long time, was what I felt. Thank you very much.
Okay, the floor is open. Yes, Destiny.
Thank you, Amar, and thank you, all of you. But this is a question that has been I've been thinking about through the other presentations as well. And you've all mentioned, you know, the Adivasi communities and their connection and the sort of inherent nature of their being with the planet. At what point does that alienation occur? At some point, all these communities are also then migrating, etc. Do they then carry with them that knowledge, that belief? And how does that alienation occur? So in all of you who have explored this issue and explored the context and the landscape, are you able to tell when that alienation occurs and, you know, how that could be addressed in a sense? I mean, this is for some of the others also who spoke about
it. I mean, I wanted to ask Nilanjan this question, actually, because in terms of 15 years ago, researching in and finding that agriculture universities, professors in agriculture universities were working with corporates in accessing knowledge about medicinal plants so that they could be extracted not in kilos, but like in tons and in trucks and truckloads. If this knowledge it leads to the question that do they still remember in terms of memory? In terms of is the next generation aware of the medicinal plant history and practices and so on? So my simple answer to that would be that it's very hard for me to assess how alienated the Adivasi is, what is the quotient of his alienation at this point, simply because I have no tools to even understand it. Instinctively, I can understand his worldview, but practically, if I were to be looking at the data and what I see when I travel, they are being hit so hard, and they are facing such a spectrum of forces that are entering into their existence, that many parts of the country do not function in this idealized Adivasi way, even if you are in that terrain anymore.
It's less and less. Over the course of my work, like 15 years, clearly.
It's another story. I mean, you go to many states, it's very different. So this is just us talking, in a way.
I would just like to add that it starts also with school and your ashram shalas, in which you're in hostelum. That's where you're taught shame in being, you're brought into wider mainstream culture, taught to be ashamed of your community and its ways. I also I know that I'm on this panel, but it would be good if we did have more representation, so that it's not us just acting, as mediums for this particular, for their experience. But from the satellite dish that's available in every household to a land mafia who comes in to acute climate distress and agricultural distress, nobody wants their kids to be a farmer anymore. And given your situations and where it's hunger, where it's poverty, where it's programming, where it's institutions coming in, whether it's the Vanvasi Kalyan Ashram or whether it's the missionaries or looking at that. These are not isolated worlds, and we no longer live in them, so to expect that to have no influence.
Yes, you? Yeah. The person behind
you. I think just reflecting on what all of you have been saying, I mean, the idea of valuation of nature has now existed for the last two or three decades. I mean, there have been economists who've spoken about this in terms of multiple values, monetary and non-monetary values, and whether we should actually start really debating and discussing whether this whole discussion is more about monetization and financialization of nature, and whether that really trumps choices of the Adivasi and choices of the government in terms of the solutions that you perpetuate or the choices you make to take the money from the District Mineral Foundation or the compensatory afforestation. It's really boiling down to the multiple values to a singular value, which is financial and monetizing. Just wanted to get your thoughts on it.
Ravi.
I just would like to reflect more on this idea of alienation as a generic category. I think with people who have a sensibility of growing up in a certain kind of connectivity that never loses in their life, but it becomes negotiations of different sorts. So if you take what you call indigenous person outside the context, a different kind of negotiation happens. But that doesn't mean the ability not to be alienated in certain things, this disappears. You go to a certain community, a certain landscape, a certain familiarity, you are not alienated from that. So I think it's this generic category of alienation is also a condition of memory, of connection, of community. And when you place the person outside that, people negotiate in what is available, in a sense. That doesn't necessarily mean they have become lost the capability of being non-alienated or don't have the memory or the ability not to be connected to something. So I don't think that the human sort of condition has changed so much that we've lost the ability not to be unalienated or to be alienated. I don't think we should just broadly place this markers of what constitutes alienation and how, the systemic breakdowns. That doesn't mean the self has broken down in the same place.
Yes, I'll come to you.
This is sort of extension of the question the lady asked, valuation of nature. Anyone in the panel, I wanted to understand, you know, valuation of our natural resources, what is the government of India doing, either through the Ministry of Environment and Forest or through, say, a biodiversity committee? Is there a metric? Is there a whole matrix that will then, you know, reach the valuation of our natural capital? I've just not understood that aspect. If anyone can share, or are they doing something? How they're doing is another thing. Are they really doing?
So, I mean, just partly answering your question is that the whole net present value and how it, you know, how they're coming to saying that if you cut so much hectares of land, you have to pay so much crores. That's an example of valuation. But like you said, I mean, it is valuation. It may be faulty valuation, but that's an example of how the government is valuing our natural resource and monetizing, as Kanchi put it. But it's deeply flawed, no doubt. But it is true that there are other parts of the natural resources which we are exploiting entirely without attributing any value to them whatsoever, however flawed that mechanism may be.
Yeah. I mean, my only response to your question would be actually that the need is to deny and refuse this valuation system. Whatever I said was actually leading to this, to say that, look, you don't know. You cannot length into breadth and compensate. And these are the reasons why you cannot multiply and compensate. So how are you going to compensate? Let's first discuss what you are going to, what is lost. So until and unless we are able to present what is lost and we are able to comprehend, we will not move to compensation.
My question was just that, trees cut, the topsoil gone, there are so many things, how do you ever put a tag on it?
I deny this valuation, I don't engage with it. I say that I am not even going to engage with it because actually we have not even understood what is lost. First we will discuss what is lost. When this conversation ends, then you can take it. Then we will discuss compensation.
So how do, as the thing says, how do you include it in economic and legal decision making?
See, you can. For instance, sorry, just you can. I mean, if you can agree for compensation, You can delay. If you delay, your compensation also goes up. The more you negotiate, the more you bargain, the longer you take, you probably get much more, even though ADB is insuring them against local resistance and against project delay and so on. But it's quite clear that even if you negotiate, you get more compensation. So there are many ways.
I agree with you. You just cannot put a tag, that's it.
But I think also another thing again, like what happens, like these laws like CAMPA and all this idea of that what actually lost are not being kind of like assumed and then evaluated properly. As sacred groves gets lost, there are other values also. There's belief systems, there is long traditions, there is many other things not directly related to. So the government is not anyway interested. I completely agree with that, like with Amar, what he's saying, completely deny that whole thing.
Yes, you've had it.
My question is actually very simple, and I'll keep it very simple. It's to Amar and to Nilanjan. This landscape of horror, you know, this way of looking or seeing that you're talking about, this new kind of evidence collecting, when you then make it into work and put it out, whom do you make it for? Do you make it for the alienated viewer or the unalienated viewer?
I make it for everybody. I make it as part of my own unalienation as well, my attempt to find my own self, to find the human in me. I make it for myself. At the same time, if this attempt to make it for myself is true, honest, works, has some meaning in it, it will immediately connect with whoever. So I can have policemen, and I can have crooks, and I can have businessmen, and they will connect, they will speak, they will relate to it. So for me, it's not like that, and there is really no difference. I have clearly seen that many, it's like heads of art institutions know best the nonsense of the art institution, the uselessness of the art institution. The head knows better than anybody else. So there are many people within corporations who actually understand this even better than other people who understand, even though they may be these bad guys. So I don't differentiate like that.
Okay, one last question there. Yes.
I had a question, actually, two questions. One for the last presentation for you, Amar Kanwar. I really liked your Sovereign Forest, and I would really appreciate it if you talked a little bit more about this idea also of violence. And particularly, you refer to this idea of the crime scene, but one of the main things in a crime scene and being an investigative agent is to then pin agency and accountability. So if you can actually talk about then how do you see these interconnected sort of complicit webs of actors who are actually then responsible? Because I would really like you to talk a little bit more in that vein. So that's one. And a second is sort of a more general question for the panel. Throughout the morning, listening to everybody, there's a strong sense that nature is far away from us in the city. And that and there's a lot of discussion on Adivasis, again, in sort of more remote rural areas. Except perhaps for the first presentation, talking much more about environmental law. So I'm just curious as to how you see nature in the city. And if you think of even then the whole idea of indigenous or Adivasi in the city, I'd be really interested in your perspectives on that.
You know, recently I was in Bastar and I met Manish Kunjam, who's an Adivasi and lives in Dantewada. And he works between the people and the so-called, ultra-left Maoists, and then sees that, how things are. And he was asking me, I asked him many questions and he had counter questions. And he said, who is speaking on our behalf? That's also a very important question. So like today, any of the Adivasi artists, even if we use the word Adivasi, is here. or the person who can speak for themselves to answer these questions of alienation. Because this is a very big question of alienation. Who is alienating them and how they are making choices and who are making choices on their behalf. So if we see these questions in relation to that, then I think there are many more new questions we have.
Yeah, I mean, I agree with you. If there were Adivasis here on the panel, they would be opening this issue up from their own point of view, and that would be illuminating. I am not saying that I am out to save anybody. I am saying I am out to save myself. I don't understand what is happening, and this entire, whatever I have said, is my attempt to comprehend. It's only my attempt to comprehend.
I'm just saying in general, on a larger scale, I know that I'm just reacting to the authentic voice,
you know, and I'm just reacting to who is supposed to speak on whose behalf and not on, so I'm saying let's not speak on anybody's behalf because we are in pretty deep shit generally. So it is possible over here for us to speak on our own behalf. As far as your questions were concerned, I cannot answer your second question. Maybe somebody else could. The first question, very briefly, I would say, you know, for instance, having if one is able to see, say, 300 varieties of rice that are lost in a piece of land, then immediately it prevents you from comprehending it in land rate value of what is lost. You need to figure out what it means for that knowledge system to have got lost, how much does that cost, etc., etc. What's the web of players in this entire thing and where to go from? I would just request that maybe because we have a last session on the last day, that for me that's connects to in that, and I would try to bring it up then in the last session to answer your question.
Can I speak about the city thing? Which is essentially, I think that the public health crisis is a great way, that is a great way or an unfortunate way, which is the air pollution crisis is kind of driving home environmental justice movements in cities, where there's the RA colony movement. And for us to realize many people who alienated from the forest are also going to Borivali to see what that is and why is it that a metro shed, okay, might reduce emissions in a certain way, but can we afford to lose a forest? There is a Delhi tree felling drive which is being opposed by citizens everywhere. People in Raipur are realizing or otherwise that all of the thermal power plants that are in your hinterland or in Chhattisgarh and otherwise have an effect on us, whether it's a water crisis in Johannesburg or Bangalore being brought to their knees, where do we go from here? Whether it's a food crisis where farmers are like, we are not going to sell milk or rations to the city. I think these are connections which are kind of forcing us, and I mean, to become more connected, and also the internet and cognitive generosity or cognitive alarm and bridging these connections. So I would see that.
Actually, I have a couple of questions for Amar and one for Ravi and the exchange between Ravi and Nilanjan, but I think people are losing their intellectual appetites for other sorts of appetites. So I'll raise it in the last session when there's going to be a roundtable discussion. Okay. Thank you very much.
Thank you.